I'm here with Lauren today. We're in the archaeology lab at Ferry Farm again, and we are going to talk about vesselization. Lauren is going to rejoin us in a moment, but first I want to talk to you a little bit about what vesselization is and why we do it. So at our archaeological site, we excavate a lot of ceramics. And we want to think about them not just in terms of individual sherds, but as whole vessels and what they can tell us about the Washingtons. That's basically our end game, is trying to learn more about the behavior of humans, in this case, the Washington family. And we can learn a lot about that from the things that they've left behind. So what we have here are a lot of different sherds, and our goals are to put them together, mend them as best we can, and create vessels out of them. Not necessarily whole vessels, but enough so we can figure out what the objects were and how they were used. And now Lauren is going to show us all the steps in the vesselization process.
The first step in a vesselizing project is locating all of the artifacts of a certain wear type, and we use our database to do this.
And we have cataloged over 750,000 artifacts, and from them I'm going to filter for only the white salt glaze, which is the project we're working on right now. Come up to wear manufacturing technique, and then select only the white salt glaze. Now that we have a list of the artifacts we need, we can go get them from storage.
Finding all these artifacts represents quite an investment of time, but it's worth it for the knowledge they can give us about the people who lived here. And we look through the bag to find the correct artifact. Here it is. And I'm going to put the removed slip in the bag so that the next staff member knows where the artifact has gone.
We're back in the archaeology lab at the mending table, and here's where our staff and volunteers work on vesselizing. The table might look like chaos, but it's actually carefully separated into sections. These sections make it easier for us to mend and see patterns. Right here, we have all the bases. Over here, we have all the rims. We have burned pieces over here, just plain body sherds over there. Here we have handles, knobs, and various molded decorative pieces. This is the piece we pulled from storage earlier. It's time to add it to the table. And this looks like a rim to me, so I'm gonna put it in with the rims. It's a bit like doing a puzzle, except imagine you took 20 puzzles and you dumped them all on a table, mixed them together, and threw out half the pieces. That's the kind of puzzle we're working on here. We won't actually get like a whole teacup back together. We're just trying to get enough to get a look at what the object once was. Now, Lauren has been spending countless hours, I can assure you, piecing together these little white bits and turning them into vessels that I can identify. The way she's been doing this is by using this blue painter's tape. And this is important because this tape doesn't leave a residue on the ceramics. So whenever we remove the tape, there won't be any conservation issues involved. So what I've got in front of me now are a number of different vessel types that I can use to say more about the Washington family. For instance, she's put together this dinner plate we can see now. We've also got quite a few ointment pots. This is a particularly cute one. So we know that the Washingtons were mixing their own medicines on the property. And items such as this saucer base. So putting together all this information, I can talk about what items the Washington family purchased for use in their dining room and kitchen, how they used them, judging by the use wear patterns, what the items may have cost whenever they were purchased, and get a better idea of what their dining room table would have looked like. And this is particularly important because we are reconstructing the Washington house, and we eventually want to put items in it that are reflected by the archaeological record. And this is a large part of how we do that.